We'll start with Lutz. He will talk for, we'll give him like 30 minutes, and then we have 15 minutes break, and then we'll come back for discussion, and then we'll give him also a chance to reflect on the response. Nahla will be ready if there is any difficult questions or if she wants to intervene at any point, we will give her the chance to. I will be the chair and moderator of this discussion. And there is 3 points that OpenSIM they would like to announce. First, that the safety exit is this way, the fire door. The same one that
we came from.
And then the second thing, that's OpenSIM is going to put everything on video. So if anyone who doesn't like it to be, his photo to be taken or anything, that he should notify Nahla. And also no one has the right to take any photos, because OpenSIM is of the absolute right to cover this event and to publish. They will put it also on Facebook and on their website. The third point, I forgot it. I don't think it's important. Yeah, okay. Yeah, we will finish by 5 sharp, because this we have to give this room to other Sudanese event at 5 sharp. So I hope we will be precise. So, Lutz, I don't need to tell anyone about who is Lutz, but I feel free to say what we are going to talk about today.
Right, thank you very much, Ali. Thanks in particular for apologizing on my behalf, because I should be doing the apologizing. So sorry for running slightly late. Couldn't be avoided. And obviously, on a Sunday afternoon, I think it's great that all of us made it here. And the theme of today's talk is what I titled An Instrument of Power or an Expression of the Rule of Law. And if we look at constitutions all around the world, I think it's not unique to Sudan, that sort of tension, because obviously any constitution is a founding document and sets the framework for how a country is to be governed. And there are all sorts of constitutions, and there are a number of ways of how we can look at constitutions. But I think the ultimate test for a constitution is whether it provides a lasting framework for a country to govern itself and to deal with disputes and enable the population at large to exercise sort of its democratic rights, but also protect individual rights. And what I want to do is basically to take a step back, look at the constitutional developments in Sudan up to the present day, covering also the most recent constitutional amendments in January 2015, which are quite important, and then to look ahead what the prospects are for constitutional reforms in Sudan at the present moment. There was quite an interesting paper by Professor Ali Suleiman Fadil. He's a constitutional law professor in Sudan. Unfortunately, he doesn't write as much as he probably should on the constitution. It's much better when you meet him in the evenings over a falafel and a cup of tea, and then you can talk endlessly about the constitution. So he's a very knowledgeable man on that. And he, in an article he wrote, said that Sudan is a country in search of a constitution. That is for him the main theme. And when we look back to the early days, it will become very clear how true that is. Because the first constitution was actually, again, sort of an interim one, where Sudan, upon becoming independent in 1956, adopted the self-government statute of 1953 as its first transitional constitution. Now and then, almost immediately, a theme started to emerge, which a pattern that you see repeat itself, which is that there was a discussion about what constitution Sudan should have. There were democratic deliberations beginning in 1956, but they were then cut short when Aboud came to power. Now, so later in 1964, a constitution was then adopted which amended the initial transitional constitution, and again you had a transition to democracy. So what happened? Further deliberations by a national commission of what the constitution should be. Now, one of the problems of democracy compared to authoritarian regimes, if you can look at it that way, is that deliberations are a bit more time consuming than pure fear, because if you're in power, obviously you can expedite things if that fits the purpose. So again, there were lengthy deliberations resulting in a draft constitution in 1968. But you all know what happened shortly thereafter, Nimeiri coming into power. So even at that point, there had been no constitution that had actually been adopted by a democratically legitimate body. Now, under Nimeiri in 1973, a constitution was adopted, which was a result of a number of debates and also included references to the rule of law. And it has been said that it had a modicum of constitutionalism, so there was a certain separation of power, notwithstanding, of course, that Nimeiri's regime was a one-party state. So. But still, there were a number of shortcomings with that constitution also. And its name, the permanent constitution, obviously didn't last very long, because come 1985, with the change to another democratic regime, a further transitional constitution was enacted based on the 1956 and 1973 constitution. So, and again, what happened was with the transitional government and the new parliament in place, further deliberations about the new constitution, but limited progress was made until 1989. And again, then, that was the last time a democratic sort of regime was in place, no constitution was adopted. So the first finding at this point already is there hasn't been any constitution in Sudan today that has actually been adopted by a democratically legitimate parliament or a referendum of the people, which is usually the sort of the mode for adopting constitutions. What happened after 1989, so in the initial phase, the country was mainly ruled by decrees, presidential and revolutionary decrees, and it took then until 1998 that the constitution was adopted by the current regime. I won't be going into much detail of that constitution, but it was said to be modeled along sort of the Islamic law lines, stressing very much the supremacy of Sharia. And as you all know, then came the Comprehensive Peace Agreement, which was finally adopted in early 2005. And as part of the Comprehensive Peace Agreement, an interim national constitution was adopted in 2005 also. Well, that's the constitution that is still currently in place, and I will be looking at that in a bit more detail in a minute. But I just want to sort of look at some of the lessons that we can draw from the developments until 2005. So the first obvious striking point is that there's never been a permanent constitution in Sudan that has really provided a framework for the country. And the constitutional history, of course, reflects the lack of political stability. And what you see is that whichever regime came into power then used constitutions as they saw fit, sometimes governing even without a proper constitution in place. So the constitution, coming back to the title, was really seen A as an instrument of power, or B as not necessarily that important after all. There's also, I think, there is a lack of respect for a constitution as the governing document for a country. Because obviously any constitution raises the question, but to what degree does it reflect people's will, how was it enacted? So that is one of the findings we can make. And obviously there's the other finding is that democratic transition regimes have struggled with adopting a constitution. But again, I think it reflects the difficulties that these regimes have faced. And obviously there's a number of contentious questions always to be resolved. One of the issues, of course, the status of Islamic law in the constitution, the presidential system versus the prime ministerial regime, the question of centralism, federalism. So all of these issues have been discussed from time to time, but during times of democratic transition, there just wasn't sufficient agreement on these questions to act more quickly than happened eventually. And what we see is then what is called sort of a lack of constitutionalism. And that constitutionalism is a sort of widely used notion, which means that that there is a clear separation of powers, that the government is actually limited by the law, respects due process, and that the constitution provides an order that anyone in government is bound by. And obviously that also goes together with the separation of powers between the three branches of government, which is the executive, the legislature, and the judiciary. And of course the idea of constitutionalism is heavily influenced also by historical experiences such as the US approach to constitutionalism. Well, coming from Germany myself, a country that has in part suffered from being overly idealistic and looking to shape society and the world according to ideas, I was actually quite struck when I read about sort of the American history of constitution making. Because the American constitution has been quite, for all its shortcomings, has been quite successful over time. But actually what they did was not based on a great vision of an utopian life. It was based on distrusting each other, having checks and balances in place, knowing that if you give someone too much power, it's open to abuse. So it was a very realistic approach. And constitutionalism, substantively, is based on these notions that there are proper checks and balances need to be in place, and that there should be a certain order for how to settle disputes. You know, what if there is an issue of whose power it is, that there is a constitutional court in place, which ideally is above politics. But in Sudan, you have actually witnessed the opposite. There have been a lot of sort of ad hoc arrangements based on constitutional compromise as well, and also you don't have a history of a strong constitutional court with independent judges who would have been able to set and enforce these limits in practice. But constitutionalism is not only about the substance, but it's also how you make a constitution so that people have a say in the constitution making process. Now that can be done in a number of ways, because of course you can say, if you have an elected parliament, that parliament should then have the ultimate say. But what you find in a number of countries is that you have specific constitution-making bodies, commissions, broad-based coalitions where these issues are then discussed in some detail, and in some countries put to a referendum as well. So that signals that constitutions are actually not just an ordinary law, but are something superior. And there have been some very interesting developments also in neighboring countries, like in Kenya, where you had a very drawn out process of constitution making, where civil society and a number of groups were actually closely involved to say, well, these are the issues that matter to us, and discussed in great detail the various alternatives. And obviously, if this kind of participation is then reflected in a constitution, and if it relates back to also the positive constitutional history of a country, at least you cannot accuse a constitution of being sort of alien or not being responsive to what people want. I mean, what is then made of that in practice is another question. Even in Kenya, I think obviously the underlying power structures and a constitution is not a magic wand. You know, it will be ultimately subject to politics, unavoidably so, but at least it provides an important reference point where people can say, well, this is not what we actually wanted, this is not what the constitution says. So it is a yardstick also for the legitimacy of political actors. But if there's no respect for a constitution in the first place, then it will also not serve as a yardstick. Now, when you talk about constitution in Sudan, many people may say, well, nobody cares anyway about the constitution, so it's then not used to say, no, you should stick to the constitution in the first place. I think the interim national constitution is perhaps different, because obviously it was based on a very important agreement, namely the Comprehensive Peace Agreement, which had a degree of legitimacy. The problem with that was, of course, that the agreement itself was a power-sharing deal, and again, there was a lack of participation from civil society, more broadly from other political parties, from those representing women. So there are a number of shortcomings in that process of the Comprehensive Peace Agreement, which then also, in a way, reflected to some degree in the interim national constitution. Nonetheless, in terms of its contents, there are a number of important features, power sharing arrangements in the constitution. You have a degree of what is called decentralization of power, so you have the center and the state, so stronger state powers. You have more, in theory at least, institutional control of executive conduct, especially the Constitutional Court has been given considerable powers. You have monitoring bodies such as the National Human Rights Commission to be newly put in place. And you have a Bill of Rights, which grants fairly extensive rights based on international standards. The Bill of Rights has certain shortcomings, but I don't think we'll have the time to go into greater detail there. But I think it's fair to say that for Sudanese history, it's a landmark Bill of Rights, because it does cover the key civil and political rights. Not so much the economic, social, and cultural rights, which are only sort of recognized as guiding principles, but nonetheless, it was seen as a very important acknowledgement of the lack of human rights protection in previous constitutions, even though there were some elements of rights protection, but not to the same degree. Now, if you look at the contents of the interim national constitution, you would think, yes, I mean, it has the key ingredients that are needed for constitutionalism. But one of the problem was, of course, the way it was adopted, basically coming out of the comprehensive peace agreement, and also that fairly quickly it became very clear that there wasn't much impetus on either side to actually adhere to its basic tenets, because as part of the power sharing deal, the National Congress Party sort of kept the levers of power in the north, and obviously the SPLM then in the south. So the democratic transformation that the interim national constitution was meant to usher into never really materialized. And one of the reasons for that was also that there was no corresponding legislative and institutional reforms to actually put the constitutional mandate into practice. Because what a constitution does, it sets out the main principles, and it's actually a call to action for the lawmaker as well to then put that into practice, which didn't necessarily happen. For example, if you take the National Intelligence and Security Service, constitution said should have intelligence functions only. Well, as we know, it has much more than that. And in 2010, the National Security Act was enacted, which gave the NISS broad powers, going way beyond the constitution, on the face of it, unconstitutional. Normally, that should have been challenged before the Constitutional Court, but given the composition of the Constitutional Court and its history, and the knowledge across society that the NISS has a very special role to play, I think that there was very limited prospect of the Constitutional Court declaring such a law to be unconstitutional. And it has sided in the large majority of cases that we've looked at, has actually sided with the government. Now, that was one of the problems. Now, come 2011 and the secession, of course, the situation has changed again. Because the South has now embarked on its own constitution-making process. There is a transitional constitution in place. They have a constitutional review commission chaired by Manakolda Tia. And that was meant to finish its work fairly early, by I think 2015 already initially. Not before, but that has been postponed now to 2017, so that due to the conflict and the political instability, they are also experiencing problems in adopting a lasting constitution. Now in the north, the old Sudan, if you like, now there's also has been a lot of debate about the constitutional review process, meaning that there should be a new constitution. And a number of actors have started discussing what the new constitution should look like. President Bashir said, now we're going to make the constitution a document that properly reflects the nature of the Islamic State. Then, of course, various civil society groups have put forward their own proposals, also more liberal notions, or secular notions as well, even of what they want a constitution to look like. So basically, like in most other of these processes, you find a whole range of positions of what people want to see reflected in a constitution, and I think that's healthy pluralism at that stage. Now, how feasible any of that is, I think we'll come back to that and we'll, we can discuss that later on. What I think was very important that there has been some effort to have broader constitutional debates in society. Not so much on the part of government, but civil society has taken steps, IAM Center and others. So we also had, had a meeting, I brought some copies on constitutional rights in Sudan with the law faculty of the University of Khartoum. So there were a number of efforts, so some progress has been made there. The UNDP has also embarked on a process of getting various groups together in closer collaboration with the government to have a constitutional debate. But my impression, and I would invite your views on that, is that that has largely petered out and never got close enough to develop sort of the momentum that would have been needed to have, to become a proper constitutional debate. Also because there is no body in place, a proper national constitutional review commission that is broad-based and that would be able to reflect these views and bring them out into the open. So some steps have been taken, some debates have been had, but there is a considerable lack of momentum. And against that background, come January 2015, all of a sudden you have quite significant constitutional amendments, which I guess also reflect that the government ultimately, if they want to change the constitution, if it serves their purpose, they can do that very quickly without broader public debate. And let me just go quickly through some of these changes in January 2015. Quite significant. The main thrust of these amendments is to give the center more power. So it strengthens the president and the center of the state at the expense of the states, which lose some of their powers, also in relation to certain institutions such as the judiciary, where it's emphasized that it's a national institution. And then it gives greater powers to the National Intelligence and Security Services and the police. The National Intelligence and Security Service, what it does is, A, the amendments basically validate what is already the reality, that the security service have these broader powers, but also give them more or less carte blanche to develop their powers as they see fit, because they have a very broad broad notion of security, and the security forces then also set, if you like, the rules of how these powers should be exercised. The police as well, the changes to the constitutional provisions, it's quite noticeable, because before that it said that they should reflect, police should reflect the diversity of the country, should be based on the rule of law, should respect the rights of people. All of that has gone now. So it's quite significant, going beyond purely cosmetic changes, because it's both broadening the powers of these institutions, but also taking out any of the language that was so typical of the Comprehensive Peace Agreement and the initial original interim constitution. There's also another important amendment on the issue of land, which is basically sort of legalizing what has been called land grab, because it, when it comes to land, now it gives considerable powers to the president to expropriate land by means of decree, and it's all now subordinate to investment interests. So again, it's interesting to see that that in itself was actually turned into a constitutional provision. The political backdrop of all of that is, of course, that there have been a number of challenges to the center and ongoing conflicts where the National Intelligence and Security Service and the police have played a greater role. And therefore it was seen as necessary to have these changes, apparently. But you may also say, why then change the constitution? And I think that's quite an interesting question to debate further, because it could have been just done outside of the constitution, but obviously the government saw that it's important enough to actually change the constitutional provisions, and perhaps it's also a case of testing the waters there and also showing that who is in charge of the constitution making process. From a rule of law perspective, I think the shift is very worrying, because it signals further powers to the executive and even lesser controls by other bodies, in particular the judiciary. And the constitutional amendments themselves were also enacted in a way that was highly questionable from a procedural point of view, because the actual constitutional procedure for amendment was not adhered to. It should have been done by a two-thirds majority, which it wasn't. And then also, because it touches upon the comprehensive peace agreement, it should have been done with the agreement of parties to the comprehensive peace agreement when it comes to the question of the rights of the center and the various states. So it would therefore probably be open to a challenge before the Constitutional Court, and some people have considered the possibility of doing that, but as far as I know, no one has yet taken that step and has spent the $1,000 that are needed to initiate such an action. But it might be worthwhile challenging it on procedural and substantive grounds before the Constitutional Court. Now, very briefly, in terms of the outlook, and what we would want to discuss about what is the prospect for sort of different kind of constitution, what is the agenda for change. Now, of course, we have the national dialogue, which is a very interesting alternative forum, if you like, because obviously a lot of the issues that should be part and part of the constitutional review process are in principle also part of a broader national dialogue. So the national dialogue could, in theory, reinvigorate the constitutional debates. I say in theory because obviously there have been lots of sort of trials and tribulations when it comes to the national dialogue, and it's still very much up in the air to see whether that actually has the potential to bring about the kind of changes that one would need to see in place to have a more stable constitutional order. And the problem within the current political setup is, of course, where there is a history of a lack of respect for the constitution, what prospect is there that even if you have certain constitutional provisions in place, that there will be respect for that in situation where it is seen as threatening the current political status quo and the power of the government. But I think there are certain questions that need to be addressed and discussed further, which is the question of presidential or prime ministerial system, the nature of federalism, which is not that clearly defined, because of course states have been put in place, but then they were seen as an extension of the center, and they haven't had you haven't had the local power and the state power that is needed for a proper federal system. Then having an affected protection of rights, as I said, there is a Bill of Rights in place, but that hasn't worked that well because the Constitutional Court wasn't strong enough, the National Human Rights Commission hasn't got the powers and the independence it needs, and the legislative reforms haven't taken place. And then the biggest immediate issue of immediate concern, of course, institutional reform of the judiciary, security services, police, army, and so on. So there's a number of areas which would all need to be addressed seriously, and at the same time for a proper constitutional reform to work. Because if you have a constitution that doesn't address the underlying structural problems in the system that have contributed to the lack of political stability, then it's likely to be stillborn, or then it will be abused again or ignored at the convenience of whoever is in power. And I think that is the biggest challenge now, also I guess for civil society, is perhaps not to have look at any new constitution as a wish list of what should be in place on paper, but to say, well, if we are serious about a new constitution as a lasting framework for a political order in Sudan, then we need to address all these various issues and think very closely in light of the history of how they should be reflected in the Sudanese constitution. And therefore one should be as distrustful as the Americans rightly were of power and how it is exercised, and how can that be achieved in a situation like in Sudan. And I think one needs to then also look beyond the current government, because if you look at the history, the lack of constitutional sort of stability and political stability cuts right back to the beginning of that process. So I think whoever lays a claim to power in Sudan would have to face up to that question, well, what is our record of recognizing limits to our own powers? What are our visions of power? And I think it's also at the people's level, if you wish someone to take power in Sudan, maybe they are now opposed and they are now the good guys, but once they come into power, what guarantee is there that they won't be abusing power either? And I think that is the problem in a lot of the systems that lack stability and respect for constitutionalism. That, and we see it also in the Arab Spring. You know, if you don't have the time to discuss all these issues in depth and to address them properly, either there may be a backlash, or the new regimes may then repeat past mistakes. The dilemma is, of course, whether that time is actually there. But I think it's what the least that could be done, I guess, from a civil society perspective, is to be prepared and to have the analytical tools to then critically engage with whatever processes there are, be it now as part of the national dialogue, be it as part of a renewed
exceeding the limits.
As you should be able to tell by the tone of my voice, these are my closing statements, so to speak. But you cut me short in my very last sentence. So over to you. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you so much, Lutz, for this very interesting presentation about you went through the history and the background of the constitution making in Sudan, and it looked very clear that the quest for the permanent constitution is a chronic question along the history of Sudan, and still we don't have any permanent constitution, and we don't think we'll have it before 5 years, because the machine is already renewed it for 5 years. And I think that we will have a break, but I would like to remind you with the main point that we would love to discuss with you, which is raised, that the question of constitutionalism in Sudan and throughout the experience of the Sudanese with regard to the institution, which we call it in Arabic and Fasl bayn al-Sultat, the check and balance, which is very, very important question. And also the question of we never have a permanent constitutional court in Sudan, and also the constitutional court after it being founded after 2005 according to the international constitution, it was not able to defend people's right and to defend the constitution. So the question was Lutz raised that because the way it's been appointed and it's came from the NCB, from the, it's like an agreement between the NCB and the SPLM. So because like the question is, it's a court, it's a constitutional court, regardless the political negotiation behind that, from where this weakness is also coming from, the, our judges themselves. And also with the people engagement in the constitution making, like the experience as Lutz mentioned, the Kenyan, and we have, they say that our experience with engagement in constitution making doesn't get that kind of momentum, which mainstream the question of constitution that people want in Sudan. And is it also, the international constitution, it has Bill of Rights, but as Lutz referred to the, also to the constitutional court, that it was not able to protect the right enshrined in the Bill of Rights, but it's also the first time in Sudan that we have Bill of Rights and we have independent constitutional court. The question is it right that we can blame the Sudanese themselves that they missed the opportunity of making the achievement of the CBA and the international constitution reality in Sudan by engaging more than just leaving it to the politicians to do whatever? And it's be nice if we talk about the last amendment, the constitution, and the question of why the government is amending the constitution, which is it so important for the government to do what it wants to do through the constitution amendment? It's a very interesting question, and because like the point Lutz mentioned, the land, do you need to make all of this on the constitution? Why you don't make like legislations? Or why they put this emphasis on a specific issues in Sudan, they put it in the constitution. And like, but it's very interesting because I've read through the amendment, after any amendment, they put the justification for the amendment. And I think if you want to make a justification for constitution amendment, you have to write at least like 3 or 4 pages, if it's not paragraphs. But they put one sentence for the justification why they amended this provision within the constitution. And yeah, I think it's made by what's her name?
Bedria.
Because it's for why they took all the powers from the states with regard to the election of the walis, and they gave it again to the president. The justification, she said, to affirm the legitimate power of the president as being elected by all the Sudanese. So I'll stop here, and if Nahla, you would like to reflect now or after the break?
After.
Okay, so we'll have 15 minutes, and we'll come back now. That means we'll come at 4. 4 or...
10 minutes, actually.
Okay, 10 minutes.
Yeah,
you
only have three.
Seven, yeah. Okay, seven to four.
Yep.